So the title of my message today is The Day is Coming and the Day is Here. Now, some of you may look at that title or hear that title and think, what does that mean? That's an oxymoron, if I've ever heard one. That's a paradox that doesn't work. But it's true. It is true. One truth does not negate another. And so in scripture, we're going to start off in Luke 21, and that's pretty much where we're going to stay, is in Luke 21. And so for right now, I'm just looking at verse 28, and it reads, "Now when these things begin to happen, look up and lift your heads, lift up your heads, because your redemption draws near." Now, how many of you are excited because your redemption draws near? Amen. We know that it is drawing near. That is super exciting. And saints, that is where we are right now. That is not something that is afar off, way over there where you can't even see it. You can see it, and it's coming. He is coming. And it is not a day to tremble or to fear as in the way the world fears when they see things going on. No, it's a day to be excited. It's a day to rejoice, for our redemption draws near. This is the day that we are in. It is here and it is coming. Amen. God is so good. What just absolutely blows me away is, well, so many things, but one of the things that absolutely blows me away is the fact that the darker it gets, the brighter he looks. We can see him more brightly and more clearly because the day is getting darker. The world is dark, and it is getting darker, and things are getting worse. But we can clearly see him defined. We know what is right and what is wrong, what is of him and what is not of him. Even the world can see these things. The world can see there is something starkly different. Something absolutely starkly different. How is this so different? And maybe they can't name it. Maybe they can't put a finger on it. They can't label it. They can't define it. But we know what it is. We know exactly what it is. It is Jesus. It is Jesus manifesting himself in a very powerful way right now in this hour. Whew, God is so good. So I'm moving to Luke 21 verses 8 through 19 and then 25 through 28. Actually, starting in verse 5. I'm sorry. Starting in verse 5. Luke 21, 5. "Then as some spoke of the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and donations, he," Jesus, "said, these things which you see, the days will come in which not one stone shall be left upon another that shall not be thrown down. So they asked him, saying, Teacher, but when will these things be? And what sign will there be when these things are about to take place? And he said, Take heed that you not be deceived. For many will come in my name, saying, I am he, and the time has drawn near. Therefore, do not go after them. But when you hear of wars and commotions, do not be terrified. For these things must come to pass first, but the end will not come immediately. Then he said to them, Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be great earthquakes in various places and famines and pestilences, and there will be fearful sights and great signs from heaven. But before all these things, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. You will be brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. But it will turn out for you as an occasion for testimony." Brothers and sisters, and I mean brothers and sisters, because we are in this together. Brothers and sisters, days may be darkest. You may be persecuted, and actually it's telling us we will be. You will be persecuted. You will be brought before kings and rulers. You will be thrown into prisons. But it will testify. It will be a testimony to who God is. It will not testify to who we are, for we are but vessels. But it will testify to the great light, to Jesus Christ, to the Creator, to the Savior of the world. That's what it's going to be. It's going to be a testimony to who He is. That is what is happening right now, and that is what is to come. We are in that day right now. We hear about our brothers in Belarus, our brothers and our sisters in Belarus, who were taken out of their church. The government took over their church. And what did they do? They had church right outside. And it testified. It brought people into the church. And the church was right outside. There was no building, but it testified. And people said, wait a minute, this is different. How is this different? What we go through for the name of Christ, for the sake of Christ, is not about us. It is about Him. It will testify and bring light, not to us, but to Him. It will point others to Him. This can seem really scary. I know it. I mean, it sounds scary. You know, you're thinking, man, I don't want to go to prison. I mean, who says, hey, I want to go to prison, right? I mean, I'm not standing around saying, I want to go to prison. But have I prepared myself? Because this is His word. And as I teach the kids in kids' church and I tell everyone, everything in here is true. Everything in here is true. Everything that is in here is true. All that it says about you, all the promises that are in here, all that is going to happen, it's true. So these things will happen. And we have to realize, are we prepared? Are we prepared? Have we come to a place of self-abnegation? Of saying, all you, Lord. If it comes down to this, will I choose myself or will I choose you? Will I choose my comfort or will I choose you? That's the day we're in. But believers, oh my goodness, it is amazing though, because He promises to be right there with us. I mean, how huge is that? He says, you are more than conquerors in the midst of a prison. Yes, we know somebody in the Bible. We know a couple of people in the Bible who were in prison, correct? And they shouted out and they worshiped. And we know that God is there in the midst with you because He has promised it. And when you asked Him to come into your heart, the same thing I tell my kids, when you asked Him to come into your heart, there is nothing, there is no way, there is no hand that can pluck you out of His hand. There is no way that anybody can separate Christ from you. You are one in the same. You are in Him and He is in you. So wherever you find yourself, Christ is there in the midst. And in this day, He is here and He is shining brightly. It is exciting to the world. I probably seem pretty insane. But in reality, as believers, we know truth. And the truth is that we're sane and the world's insane. And where we stand in truth, that is sanity. That is truth. That is our reality. So we are seated in heavenly places right now. We are seated here and we are seated in heavenly places. Because we are in Christ, and Christ is outside of time, think about it. I mean, that's mind-blowing, Right now, we are wherever Christ is, and he's outside of time. I mean, these realities are so huge. And if we would grasp these realities and we would walk in them, imagine what the Lord could do through us. Imagine we could go up to coffins and say, rise. We could go up to an urn with ashes and say, rise. And the person would rise. We have to know who dwells within us and the day that we're in and what we are being called to. Now, we have to be responsible and realize that because that power dwells within us, it's not about us. We have to seek after him. What is he wanting? We must make sure that we are looking to him. But he's prepared us for this day. He has prepared us for this day. And we are able to say, okay, Lord, what do you want? It's amazing. Okay, we're going to continue. Luke 21, verse 14. Therefore, settle it in your hearts not to meditate beforehand on what you will answer, on what you will answer before these rulers, before these kings. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom which all your adversaries will not be able to contradict or resist. Wow. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, relatives and friends. And they will put some of you to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But, not a hair of your head will be lost. As I stand up here, I know I've lost hair. Not a hair on your head will be lost. Some of you will be put to death. Some of us will be put to death. Some of us are going to be betrayed by our parents, by our brothers, by our spouses. But he is with us. We will be taken into prisons before kings and rulers. And I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which all your adversaries will not be able to contradict or resist. We have heard it said from this pulpit right here that some people around the world, some of the people that we are in fellowship with, some who are connected to the Fellowship International, they have a voice before the rulers of their countries, of their nations. And they may not understand, but somehow they say, okay. And it cannot be negated, whatever advice is being given to them. Hey, we need to pray. Okay. It's happening right now. And it seems like, what? Yes. Some of you in this room could be placed before rulers and kings, and the Lord will be your mouth. You will not speak in your own strength, for you are not your own. You don't belong to yourself. You belong to the Savior, and he has placed in you himself. And when you open your mouth, love, truth, justice, righteousness, life will come forth. Wisdom will come forth that the world will not be able to contradict. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing to me. I'm just like, wow. It does not matter if you are beaten and bruised. Scripture tells us in Isaiah 42:3, a bruised reed he will not break. He will bring forth justice for truth. He has promised it. This is amazing, church. You are not forsaken. You will not be broken. You may be broken physically, okay, but you will not be broken. You will not fall. You will not fall. Church, the day that we are in, we will not fall. We have to realize that we stand in Christ. We will not fall because He is the rock and we are founded in Him. It doesn't matter what's happening around us. It doesn't matter if the winds are tearing as if it is a Category 5 hurricane. Doesn't matter. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. He is with us in it all. Not in some of it. Not in this little piece over here. In all of it. That is such a good promise. That is our reality. That's so huge. And sometimes we operate, I know a lot of the time, I don't operate out of that. But here lately, I'm seeing it more and more, and I'm saying, I want that. I want that 24/7. I want that 24/7. I want that 24/7. Lord, today more than yesterday. Lord, today more than yesterday. Lord, today more than yesterday. Reveal yourself to me, Lord. I want more of you, less of me. More of you, less of me. More of you, less of me. I give it all to you. Verse 25, and there will be signs in the sun, in the moon and in the stars, and on the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the seas and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them from fear and the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to happen, look up and lift up your heads because your redemption draws near. God is so good, and His promises, He keeps His promises, church. He keeps His promises. I came to the church, I believe it was in October. I know it was in 2010. I believe it was in October. And I believe that word that's back there, and you guys can look at the word that's back there. The time has come for the fulfillment of all the promises I have given you. And I read that word, and at that time, I didn't have an understanding of a Christ-centered life. I didn't know what that meant. I didn't know what a Christ-centered message was. I had grown up in church, and I knew the stories. You know, you grow up hearing Noah's Ark, and you hear, you know, Moses and Abraham and Jacob, right? And I heard these stories, and I knew these truths, and they were in me. It's just I didn't know how to walk it out. I heard about Jesus. I knew that Jesus came and that He lived a sinless life and that He died for me. But what did that mean? How does that apply to my life? You know, aside from salvation, I knew I was saved. Okay, but now what? And so I came here, and I have told you guys before, I have told you before that I started to take every word that was spoken from the pulpit. Everything. And I mean, I would sit there and I'd just take notes and I'd take notes and I'd listen and I'd take notes. I didn't know that there were CDs at that time. I probably would have had those. But I would just take notes and I prayed. I don't know where I know it was the Holy Spirit. But He revealed to me that I could pray that no word would fall to the ground. That I would be able to internalize all of it even though I couldn't recall it. And like 90% at the beginning I didn't understand. And so I saw that and I said, that's mine. I don't even know what it means, but it's mine. And so I'm looking at the word, and at the time in 2010, and probably until about a year ago, I understood that in one way. I understood that to mean all the promises that were made to me for my life. And it wasn't until about a year ago that I realized, what about the promises He made? Every promise. The time has come for the fulfillment of all the promises I have given you. Every promise. And that's not actually where the prophetic word ends. It continues. The enemy will attack to destroy. Do not fear. Do not be distracted. Do not be discouraged. All of his promises. All of his promises. The time has come for the fulfillment of all the promises I have given you. Start going through your Bible. You're going to find a promise on every page. All the promises. And they're not about us. They're all about bringing honor and glory to him, to testify of him. I couldn't believe it. I really couldn't believe it. I thought, oh my goodness. You know how you read the word when you first become a Christian? You read the word and you're like, this is so amazing, right? And then you read the word again a year later. You're like, oh my goodness, I didn't see that there. And then you read it again and again, and there's more and there's more and there's more. That's going to happen for all eternity. For Christ is eternal. God is eternal. And we are going to be seeing and being revealed and learning more of him through all eternity. And so I'm telling you, it is innumerable the promises that he has for you. He has promises that are for you and your family specifically, for you as an individual. And he has promises that are way beyond that. Like, wow. And at this point, I'm saying, I think I'm willing to give up that promise for the greater promise. What do I want? I want him more than this thing right here. I want him more than that. The day is coming when he will return, and it is near. And the day is here when we are being taken deeper. When our lives are being required, we don't have time to play around. We don't have time to give him a little bit of our lives. We don't have time. And he wants to take us into a deeper place in him. His sacrifice is worthy of our lives. He gave his life. His sacrifice is worthy of our every dream, of our every thought, of our every plan, of our every understanding, of all the knowledge that we've gotten from books. It is worthy of all of that. I give it all to you, Lord. I give it all. I give all of that up. I give up my having my family above you. He's worthy of that. Have you given him all of who you are? Or have you kept something aside for your me time? I'm tired today, Lord. I just want me time. Have you kept something aside for your parents? Have you kept something aside for your children? Said, Lord, I don't want you to touch that. I'm not going to give it all to you. I love my children. Today, I love my children more than I love you. I don't want to tell them what I need to tell them. I'll tell them another day. Have you kept something aside for your spouse? I've been wanting to be married. Now I'm married, so it's all about my spouse. No. It's all about him. It's all about him. You have to love the Lord more than you love your spouse. You have to put the Lord above your spouse. You have to. And not just you have to, you get to, as we heard from Sister Rochelle. You get to be in the most deep, intimate relationship with the Creator, with your Savior, with my Savior, with the one who gave his life. Have I set something aside and said, no, not right now. I'll wait until you come. I don't think that's what we want. In our heart of hearts, for those of us who name the name of Christ, that's not what we want. We want Him more than we want earthly things. We want Him. We want Him. We only want You, Lord. We only want You. We want You above everything else. Everything else. His sacrifice is worthy of our lives. The time has come for the fulfillment of all the promises I have given You. Have we given ourselves totally over to Him? Have we said, Your will and not my own? I'd like to play a song, and I'd like for us to just take some time before the Lord. And this song, I'm going to explain to you, because the song is in Spanish. So for those of you that don't know Spanish, the Lord really placed this on my heart. And we know that it doesn't matter if we don't all speak the same language. The Spirit is the same. Amen. And we just, yeah. So this song is called Perfume a tus pies. And it's perfume at your feet. And so she's going to be singing, and she's talking about when I think about Your love and Your fidelity, Your faithfulness, I can't do anything but prostrate myself and adore You, worship You. And when I think about how I've been and to where You've brought me, I am astounded at You, and I do not want to conform to this world. I have tasted, and I want more. I want to love You more. I want to fall in love with You more. Show me how to love You and how to live conformed to Your justice and Your truth. With my life, I want to adore You. With all that I have, with all that I am, with all that I've been, I give it to You. That my life will be to You as perfume to Your feet. When I think on Your cross and on everything that You've given, Your blood shed for me, that You bore my sin. And when I think of Your hand that has brought me to here, to this point, and for Your fidelity, I don't want to conform. I have tasted, and I want more. I do not want to conform. I have tasted, and I want more. And so that's the song that's going to play now. And I just ask that you just take some time and tell the Lord, I mean, think about it. Mary anointed Jesus' feet. To anoint His feet, she couldn't do it like this. She had to get down, and she had to prostrate herself. Let us prostrate ourselves, our lives, before the Lord. Amen. If you guys could please play it. Thank you.
Cuando pienso en tu amor y en tu fidelidad, no puedo hacer más que postrarme y adorar. Y cuando pienso en cómo he sido y hasta dónde me has traído, me asombro de ti. Y no me quiero conformar. He probado y quiero más. Yo quiero enamorarme más de ti. Enséñame a tu justicia y tu verdad. Con mi vida quiero adorar, con todo lo que tengo y lo que soy.
Cuando pienso en tu cruz y en todo lo que has dado, tu sangre por mí, por llevar mi pecado. Y cuando pienso en tu mano, hasta aquí hemos llegado por tu fidelidad. Y no me quiero conformar. He probado y quiero más. No me quiero conformar. No me quiero conformar. He probado.